Hey God, it's such a joy for me to be with you all today. Thank you so much for coming in. Just want to declare God has amazing things in store for you as well. You know, in the previous sessions, we were discussing with Prophet Joshua James on how to hear the voice of God as in a beginner's level, and then to go deeper in hearing his voice and to get more accurate results in our everyday life. But today we are going to speak on the most important aspect, the practical aspect that we can see in our everyday life on how to make decisions hearing the voice of God, how to balance between hearing the voice of God and making decisions. Because whether you realize it or not, we all have to make decisions.
Yes.
When we think about decisions, we only think of the big decisions, you know, which career to choose or the life partner. But in reality, we make decisions all the time. We make decisions whether we come now or not. We make decisions what clothes to wear, what food to eat. But every decision we make, right? So I realized one of the important things is even our clothes are prophetically connected. What I'm wearing now is prophetically connected. What I'm speaking now is prophetically connected. So when you realize the significance of every decision you make, you will be able to realize why it is important that you make the right decision. You know, why is it important that I wore this dress? Why is it important that you wore this? So when we realize to that extent, we need to realize that we need to see the balance between hearing the voice of God and to make wise decisions. So how do you start off with that?
Okay, so it's an important question about decisions, okay?
Mm.
Because whether we like it or not, our life today is the decisions that we took later, earlier, okay? So, our choices, okay,
true.
Whatever we choose and we decide, it becomes our life.
Mm.
Okay, now, in the last session or episode, we spoke about the mind.
True.
Okay, both are connected. Because your mind is the area where decisions are taken.
Mm.
See, all the deliberations, all the discussions happen in the mind.
Mm.
You weigh the pros and cons and you finally come to the conclusion of what you should do.
Mm.
Okay, be it a small thing or a great
bigger thing.
Okay, right, as you said, right from wearing a dress to something big like a marriage decision or a decision on your career.
Mm.
Okay, so what is the ideal way? The ideal way or the way that God has kept is through constant communion and relationship with him.
Mm.
Okay, see, we read about one man in the Bible. His name is Simeon. Okay, in Luke chapter 2, you find about this man. See, it's a very important decision. Okay, that particular day he came to the temple of God. It's an important decision.
Mm.
If he had not come that day, he would have missed Jesus. He would not have seen him. Because Jesus just came, he was not coming to the temple every day at the time. He was just a baby. So they brought him on the 8th day for circumcision.
Mm.
Otherwise, he would have missed. This man had always amazed me and caught my attention, and I had always wanted to live like that man.
Mm.
Because he says, the Bible says, that day Simeon was led by the Holy Spirit to be there. Yes, did he make a decision? Yes, he made lots of decisions that day to get up. Maybe he's an old man. I don't know how much struggle he had.
Mm.
Maybe his parents, children would have said, why are you going today? No need to go today. But he made a decision to come that day. But how the decision was made? The decision was made through the leading or the Holy Spirit's guidance, I would say, or the push of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit made him to go there on that particular day.
Mm.
Let's now look at the other people who were there at that time in Jerusalem, particularly the scholars.
Mm.
Okay, the scholars knew exactly where Jesus will be born. Okay, when King Herod asked them, oh, what, hey guys, what about his Messiah? Where will be born? They say, he'll be born in Bethlehem because the prophet has said.
Mm.
They studied everything. They had everything in their tips, but they missed.
True.
But this man, we don't know whether he read anything or not. He knew the scriptures. We don't have any of that record.
Mm.
But he did not miss. And he came there and he met. And Bible also talks about another lady named Anna who comes and meets Jesus.
True.
So, how did it happen?
Mm.
See, many Christians today, okay, many Christians today, many believers, they don't want to hear God.
Mm.
They want to hear from somebody. Okay? Any meeting you go to preach, in the end they come and stand in the line and pray. Yeah, it's our duty to pray for them. We gladly do that. No question about that. But they ask, okay, brother, tell us, what should we do? Should we do this or should we do that? Because they don't want to hear from God personally. Because when they tried, they couldn't hear. Okay, why they could not hear? The final root of the problem is the mind. Okay, the Adamic mind. Okay, what does the Adamic mind tell you? Okay, the Adamic mind, which is driven by the knowledge of good and evil, tells you the lies are in different level. Okay, starting with if bad things are happening, then where is God? Okay, this is at the beginner level, level lie. Then you go to the next level, if you believe in God, the lie is God will not talk to you. Okay, and the next lie is, yeah, God may talk to you, but not that much. Okay, yeah, like the way he's talking to this person and that person, like the way he's talking to this man of God, all these lies are in our mind. So when decision making comes, we struggle a lot because the foundational belief is God will not talk to us. That belief is deep inside of us. We'll not be able to find out. Okay, or some bad memories come to our mind. We trusted God back then and it failed, it backfired. All these questions, okay? So, a lot of such disappointments and questions come. So, what is the way? How to hear God, okay? Especially in terms of decisions. See, we need to come to a place where we live a life of surrender and submission to God, okay? So, when I say surrender and submission, people think about a lot of things. Basically, I'm saying a life where you surrendered your thought world to God. I'm not talking about actions. I'm talking about your thought. See, acknowledge him in all your ways. What does it mean?
To be thinking of him.
Yes, to know that he is there. Okay, you get up in the morning. Yes, you are filled with negative thoughts. Maybe you are afraid of something. You have to make some decisions. You don't know what to do. What do? You say, Lord, you're with me. And that's why I always suggest people, you spend time in the prayer in the morning. So, because in the morning, if you fix your mind on God, your mind will stay fixed the whole day. So then, decision making will become much easier. See, we many times confuse about how. We go into the how. Okay? How God will speak. Will he speak like this? Will he speak like that? Will it happen like this? Will it happen like that? See, simple thing is trusting God. Okay, how do you build the trust is when you live a lifestyle of surrender, and when you say that, Lord, this life belongs to you, so I give my thoughts to you so that you direct it. See, the word direct is very nice, because in our local terms, there is somebody called the director of the movie. Okay, the director decides almost everything about the movie. Okay, though the producer gives the money and the actors play different roles, who directs the play?
It's the director.
The play goes in the direction of the director. So when you tell God, yes, Lord, I have this thing, I have this talent, I have this thing, I have this door, or I have this job, I have this thing, but I surrender everything to you and I trust you that you will guide me. So not just saying these words, but having this as an attitude regularly. Okay. Of course, your mind, as I said, it's not going to sit quiet. Okay. It is analytical. It will ask a lot of questions, logical questions. How are you going to do this? How are you going to manage this? That's why the word trust is very important.
True.
So I said, yes, direct the word. The word direct the path is very important. And then trust is very important. So when you trust God that he will direct you irrespective of the questions, irrespective of the confusions, then you will be able to do the right thing. How do you do? Again, I said, let's not go deep into that, because the Holy Spirit, see, Jesus tells about this to the disciples. He says, when they take you to the council, okay? Council means it's not some place where you get counsel. Council means the judgment council of those days who were persecuting the believers.
True.
Jesus said, if they take you there, it's a very critical place. Okay, you say one thing wrong, they're going to stone you. They'll be always ready with the stones. So when you take you there before that judgment council, and they accuse you and all tell all those nonsense, and when you wonder what we are going to speak, do not worry, because the Holy Spirit will speak. You will not speak, the Holy Spirit will speak. See, if in that situation God can help, okay, and protect you and guide you and make you speak the right words, okay, how much more God can do in your regular things? Of course, you are not standing before judgment council every day. Everything God will guide you. See, one great example in the Bible is David. He asks everything. He asks, Lord, which direction should I go? So there is no extent to which, you know, some people say, you don't have to ask everything to God. See, I'm not saying they are wrong. See, my point is, it's up to you. You can decide to what extent you can ask God.
Trust God.
You don't want to ask God on certain things, it's up to you. Okay, I'm not saying it's wrong. But at the same time, there is a place where you ask God for everything. Okay, see, Paul and Barnabas, when they're doing ministry, see, ministry you can do anywhere, but God directs them and just go here, go there. How the directions came in different ways.
True.
See, one time a prophet comes and gives a direction. The other time, in a dream. God speaks. So the how is not actually very important, decision making. The what is important. The what means, what do you actually believe? Do you really trust him? Okay, what have you put your, where have you put your trust on? Okay, so what is the status of your mind? So that is more important. So you surrender your mind to God, you surrender your thoughts to God. See, when again, one of the things, important word in decision making is called fear. Many people make decisions based on fear. Okay, they say, what can I do? I run out of options. If I do this, it's going to backfire. What can I do? Sometimes God will ask some people to take some bold decisions, trusting him, they won't do. See, I was working in an IT company, like information technology company, for almost 6 years. And God started speaking to me to move out of that company 1.5 years before. For me, it was very difficult. So it took 1.5 years for me to make a decision. So what did I do? I was asking God, no, you confirm it. You speak to me, you confirm it, you confirm it. So God was moving, and you know, he's very, very kind. He will not push you into some decisions. Okay, he will convince you. He will speak to you, like how he convinced Abraham. So he will talk to you. So God was talking to me through different people. And he confirms, he's a good God, okay? And don't ever think decision making, you know, the devil wants you to believe that when it comes to decision making, you know, you are alone. He even paints this picture, you make a wrong decision, that's it. God will forsake you. Some people believe, you know, because I made this decision, God forsook me. See, don't worry, you might have made that wrong decision because you struggled. Because you gave into fear. Okay. So what I feel is when God says surrender, he's talking about your fear. See, what we do is we try to handle our fear on our own. That's why the Bible says, lean not to your own understanding. Lean not to the Adamic understanding. Lean not to the knowledge of good and evil understanding. Don't lean on to that. What does it mean? The wisdom of the world. What does people say? What this man says? What that man says? Don't go into all of that. Just rely on God. As you surrender your fear to him, God will start directing your paths. And you will be able to find out what is the good and perfect will of God. Okay? And one more thing about decision making is, we trusting ourselves too much.
True.
Okay. How do we practically do it? For instance, someone likes a girl, particular girl, and they look at the profile, okay, in the sense, for instance, if that person is in ministry, for example, he looks at this girl, and this girl is really good in worship leading, or he's a good soul winner, or he's good in this, good in that, so we believe, my God, this is the right decision, or we believe it could be very good, okay, and maybe at that time, somebody could drop in a prophecy also, which could be similar to that. Okay, so what we think is, okay, this is the right thing. So we have decided already. Okay, and we are using the prophecy as a confirmation. That prophecy could talk about anybody. See, God told Samuel, go to Jesse's house. Okay, if Samuel had not listened to God clearly, he would have poured the oil on the first guy or the second guy or the third guy, because everybody looked like king material.
True.
But finally, it was poured upon one man who did not look like a king. See, people might have asked Samuel that day, man, are you really sure? Did you make the right decision? But it doesn't look like that. This guy nowhere looks like a king.
Mm-hmm.
Why are you anointing him? There are more other eligible people here. Why not them?
Mm-hmm.
So, thank God Samuel could hear the voice of God, because Samuel lived a lifestyle of surrender. See, the first prayer he made was, here am I, your servant, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so his mind knew, okay, though, you know, there are some confusions, we know what is the right decision, what we have to stick to.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I believe God can clearly direct you
mm-hmm.
in decision making. And first of all, understand, he wants to help you.
Mm-hmm.
See, leave all these things if it's so confusing for you. Simple thing, ask God, Lord, please lead me.
Mm-hmm.
Tell him, Lord, I am blind to my tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
It may look nice to me today, but I don't know. I am blind to my tomorrow. I trust you. So you please take me. I am sure God will guide you very clearly, like he led Simeon right to the temple. See, there might have been many babies that day. How did he find the right one? I can't write a book on that. 10 steps to find the right baby Jesus. No, you can't do. Nobody can say. The Holy Spirit does.
True.
See, and one more thing to add with hearing God. The negative thing is fear. I spoke about fear. The opposite of fear is wisdom.
Mm.
Okay, in this context, there can be many things opposite to fear, but in the decision-making context, one side is fear, the other side is wisdom. Bible says, fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. What is that fear? Okay, again, there is a fear. Okay? So fear of the Lord is not, you know, there are some people say, I won't utter the name of God.
I know.
Okay? It's a ritualistic fear, I would say.
Mm.
Don't do this. If you do that, then, you know, God will get angry. Okay, all these things.
Mm.
Some people say, inside the church, you should not wear shoes. Then, you know, that's fear of God. See, you can have different types of reverential beliefs within you. That's
true.
A different story. But this fear of God, the Bible talks about, is the fear that should actually grip your heart if you dare to live a life not trusting God.
Mm.
That fear the Bible is talking about. The moment you realize that without God you cannot do anything, you will be gripped with that fear of God, which will actually pull you to his presence and will load you with wisdom of God.
Mm.
See, Solomon, when he was becoming king, he had everything. What he lacked? Okay, no problem with money, no problem with property, no problem with people. He had a kingdom with which David had earned so much money and kept it. And it's a prosperous kingdom. But he goes to God and says, I have all these things, but if I don't have wisdom, I can't do anything. So give me your wisdom. He says, I have to govern the people. I have to rule this country. So I need your wisdom. And because wisdom will help you for right decision making. Okay, so wisdom is also the channel through which you hear the voice of God, and it is converted into written instructions or divine instructions which you should do. So wisdom helps you in this area. So it's very important.
Mm. See, when you talk about making decisions, see, one of the things is sometimes we have this fear of, what if it's my flesh?
Yes.
Like you said, if a guy likes a girl, or if something, you have a desire in some area, so it could be you think it's God just because some prophecies fit into the thing. So how does one balance between hearing God in such a position and to make it, no, I have to decide in the right way?
See, as I said, wisdom is a very important tool here. Wisdom will explain to you what you're doing. Or in other words, wisdom will expose your foolishness to you. So that you will know, see, what is foolishness? Foolishness is believing something to be right, but it's not right. In fact, it's damaging. So here, in this case, you're believing some person to be your life partner wrongly, and you're misusing the prophecy, misunderstanding the prophecy also. Wisdom will shed light and say, no, this is not the thing. You be careful. This is one thing. In a very practical sense, I would say simply, wait for confirmation. Don't rush into decision making. See, many times we rush. We feel, if you miss this bus, that's it. This is the last bus. Okay, this is a lie. Very big lie. You know, a lot of people married, I would not say wrong person, but without waiting for God, they made some wrong decisions because they thought they were in a hurry. So recently one person came to me and she wanted to know for her daughter and a proposal had come. She wanted to know whether it's the will of God or not. You know what God told me? God told me she is gripped with fear. The fear that what will happen to my daughter? If she's not married now, that's it, her life will be gone. All kind of fears people's heart is gripped with. Okay? Because they heard stories, they have the past and all these things. If that is the case, I'm telling, don't take any decision now. First go to God and sort out your fear. Surrender your fear before God and tell God, Lord, I'm not able to fix my heart. My heart is full of fear. So please take this fear away from me. So that's the first step. And don't rush. That's the first point. Second point is wait for confirmations. Wait for confirmation. You will not lose anything. And God is not going to say, ah, man, you're wasting too much time. He won't say that. He understands you. He understands that you are flesh, you are made of, you came from the ground. He understands. So he is a patient father who will confirm. And you will confirm the word through many people. Wait for that. Okay? And then take a decision. And once you are clear, once you are convinced that it's from God. See, there is a place where you get convinced by God. I would say don't dare to step into any long-term decisions without coming to a place where you are
absolutely sure,
confirmed by God. You have that divine peace inside of your heart. First of all, understand it is possible for you. Don't think, for the man of God, God will talk to me. Not to me. Yes, God will talk to you and give you the peace. Just like with a childlike faith, ask him, he will direct your paths. You will make great decisions.
Like Colossians 3:15 says, let peace be your empire.
Yes.
So I remember a time when a great opportunity came for the ministry. So I spent 1.5 hours, I went in the traffic to that place, but I didn't have peace. Then I just spent 10 minutes without any peace and unrest. I decided I'm going to walk back and I came back. So, I mean, however good a door is, however good an opportunity is, however good somebody is, don't make a decision just because out of the, the fire or the feeling and the stuff like that. You know, let peace be your empire. Yes. And one more thing God taught me is, today we may have a lot of feelings. I mean, whether it's a relationship or ministry, so many people started the ministry like, I can also do it. And then they start, or, I have this feeling for this person, and they start. See, feelings is not what is going to run the show.
Correct.
It's not going to run the ministry. It's not going to run your marriage. It's commitment by the end of the day.
Yes.
Because after 10 years, you're not going to have the same feeling you had, when you got married. Or it's not the same emotions that you have or the fire you have for the ministry. It's commitment that will take you through. So if you really need to make a decision, see if you're committed to whatever you are seeing. Now, for example, if you look at somebody you like and you want to marry, look at all the pros and cons that are going to come into the picture. You look at the negatives about that person. Can you handle them on a long run? Today, it may feel like, okay, I feel all this great stuff, but are you committed, to that person, even though they have those negatives, even down the line, after 10 years, after 20 years? So look at all the pros and cons, look at all the plus and minus before making a decision. If you talk about ministry, it's not just, what happens on the platform. There are a lot of things behind the scenes that we have to go through. Are you willing to go through all that? Are you willing to go through all the sacrifice? Are you willing to go through all this? So before you make a decision, always go through all the plus and minus that comes into the picture. Not just the plus, not just the feelings you have. Think of it, what would happen 10 years down the line? And then you make the decision. So one last question regarding making decision is, this is a question that I always have. Like today, I feel I'm trusting God and I'm planning on something. But if I'm working on it, for example, if I'm preparing a message. I trust God and I'm preparing. And how do I balance between trusting God and preparing the message? And while I'm preaching, I'm healing, whether I'm healing to the Spirit or I'm sticking to what I had prepared. So,
see, I feel there is place for both. Okay. God teaches you certain things. You learn certain things and you prepare. Okay? And you go and preach what God spoke to you, what taught you. Okay? This is one thing. sometimes what happens is God takes over. Okay, I feel you should have room for that. You have a place for that. Sometimes when God is telling you to do something, which maybe you prepared something and God says, don't speak this, speak something else. If you don't have a room for that in your mind, you will think, I am thinking. No, I have a script, I should follow the script. I think bottom line is, we should understand ministry belongs to God. Okay, that doesn't mean you should not prepare. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is, the horse is prepared for the battle. So you do your preparation, you pray, and as per God's guidance, you read some books or you meditate on few sermons and you listen to few sermons, whatever preparation, as the Lord leads, you do that, no question about that. But when it comes to the day, when you stand and speak, you should know that, see, today many people, I think there is a big confusion. People say, my ministry. I don't think it should say like that. It is God's ministry. It is the sheep of God that is there. And every time you stand as God's ambassador. Okay. Of course, I'm not talking about Bible schools or where you have a syllabus and you go by that. No, I'm not talking about that. There you have to stick to the syllabus. No, I'm not talking about that. I am talking about preaching to the people.
This as an example as preaching, in every decision that we have to make, how do we balance between hearing God, planning in advance, and hearing God for the now?
See, I would say, whether you have a program or not, whether you are doing something or not, please hear God regularly. The basic mistake that we make is, we make hearing God as a matter of issues or events. Okay, how to see, many people pray when they have to make a decision. See, it's like taking the book one day before an exam. Okay, we all know such a preparation will always result in failure. So people don't hear God, and suddenly one day they take and they want to find out, they open the Bible, take some verse, and then they also claim God spoke to them. See, you can be wrong, you may be right. Okay, it could be either. But what I'm saying is, have a regular, lifestyle of hearing God. And your planning has to be there. You have to plan. You go to a place, you plan, right? Same way, you plan about it. But plan should be around the voice of God. Okay, the voice of God in the center, and you plan around. Based on what God said, build your plans. The problem today is people build their plans and then try to fit God inside. So that's not the way. See, it's like we all know the seed is under the ground and the roots grow, then the tree grows. Can you do the opposite? Can you cut the tree and put it somewhere and expect the root to grow afterwards? It won't happen. Okay, so there is a way everything happens. Same way, planning definitely has a place. But it comes around the plan of God and the voice of God. So that's how you see. It's like both are important. See, God told Noah to build a big ship or an ark. Do you think there was no planning? There was planning, but he was planning for what God said. He did not conceive this idea and say, "Okay, Lord, let me build this thing. I'm bored. I don't know what to do. Let me build this ark." Then you do a plan. You send a flood. That doesn't work that way.
So hope you are blessed by this session where we spoke about decision making. See, you can go by what God told you. Like God told Abraham, to offer Isaac as a sacrifice. But if he hadn't heard God for the second time, he would have killed him. So, it's important that you hear God for what he's telling you now. Okay, God told you 5 years back or 2 years back, great. But what is God telling you now?
To simply say, keep hearing.
Keep hearing, let it be a continuous person. That's why the Bible says, faith comes by the hearing of the word, not just when you hear. So keep hearing, keep walking in hearing his voice. That's what will make the difference in your life. We'll see you next time. Love you. God bless you.